we'd gather a few more people. Golly's there in the background.
Yeah.
I think David isn't there, but it was by this time we've got a producer, Sarah Mullock. A few more craft skills. I think David did quite a lot of work on that. Fred Reed, lighting cameraman. We then had advertising agencies who saw these pieces on Channel 4, and that's what kind of led us into commercial work. Yeah. The advertising market was something we hadn't. We thought, we'd seen them on TV and we'd heard that they made you a lot of money, and but it was very fickle and it was a nightmare. And the phone started going, particularly after the Channel 4 series went on air. And we kind of thought that this would be a short-lived thing. So we thought we'd do a few ads. Some of them were based on creature comforts, some of them just based on our model animation. We'd be in and out of fashion about 6 months, take the money, get some gear, and then kind of go back to short film work, Channel 4, children's work. And that would be our kind of career. Much to our amazement, the advertising works continue to this day. And it's actually, for quite a while, it proved the kind of financial backbone for the company. We learned a hell of a lot on it. I mean, I've often said it's probably the best funded film academy you can have. Partially because you're working with, and certainly in those days, the mid-80s to the 90s, some very bright advertising people. Advertising was on a roll. These are the people that come out of universities probably in actually the late 60s, early 70s, when television advertising was really beginning to build. We worked with some wonderful people like kind of John Webster, Mike Stevenson, Derek Apps, who are absolute sort of powerhouses of creativity. They wanted high production values. They were going to be answerable to their clients. We didn't really know what we were doing. And it was great in those early days to have that kind of mentoring and support. And we learned a ton of stuff. And it allowed us also to bring more people in, model makers, designers, cameramen, try and find a few more animators. And we built a small coterie of skills around us through the advertising business, actually.
Some call them toilets, some call them loos. Some are avocado, others are blue. But here's one thing you gotta get in your head. Big Dom kills all known germs, stone dead. Big Dom, right under the rim, man.
Big Dom. Big Dom.
Big Bad Dom.
The experience of working in advertising really, it feels as though it really raised the stakes, or raised the game in terms of the professionalism of the animation, as it were.
I think that's the case. I mean, you ran on fear of failure. Yeah. And I can remember waking up in a cold sweat every morning at 6 a.m, absolutely fearful of, are we going to pull this off?
The Enterprise. Unlike its predecessors, the Enterprise's memory can expand and expand to a massive 3,900K. And being the younger generation, it even offers stereo sound. The Enterprise 128. It could be obsolescence built out.
The expectation was very, very high. You know, 35mm shoots all the way through. They expected a kind of, you know, big name DOPs. It was pretty full on. And actually, oh my God. So you're learning on a very, very steep learning curve. You had the money to pull in the right people. But it does kind of pull you up by the bootstraps. So both on the craft skills, but in a way equipment and the language and what was expected.
I think you're saying that you're then coming in contact with people from the other aspects of the film industry.
Yeah, a whole bundle of sort of great DOPs in Met, and of course doing sound. You know, they expect high quality sound. So we had an editor in London that we used. Dubbing theatres, it just did absolutely raise the game.
It's almost easy to be a bit dismissive of advertising, you know, in the sort of art, as it were, of cinema, you know.
Yes.
But actually, advertising.
And somewhere there's a quote in some publication where I quoted as saying, you know, commercials are sort of anathema to animation. I mean, I was 100% wrong, actually. And it was, I'd say, a fantastic training ground for us and a great way of investing in people and stuff.
Spread a little creaminess upon your toast.
Lepact with creamy taste.
I always remember a story being that there was more, that Nick had more awards than he did frames of footage.
That's not far from the truth. Yes. Yeah. There's Nick, there's BAFTAs.
With Ang Lee, isn't it?
Yeah.
With Nick doing the Grand Day Out, did he phone up? Why did he choose Peter Salas? And did he just sort of get in touch with him?
I think he had seen him in probably Last of the Summer Wine,
right.
And wanted that sort of northern voice. Yeah. Nick's got a lovely story about him, and in that, you know, he phoned up Peter. And of course, you know, actors will, because of the National Film School, they'll go out of their way, oh, yes, I'll help you out, you're starting your career, yep, you know, so you know, they'll do it almost for nothing. And he did, I don't know, he did a session with them to do these lines. And then, and that was it, for years and years and years. And Peter Sallis says, and then I got this phone call 7 years later, and it was this chap called Park, God. And it's Nick on the end of the phone saying, I've finished. Finished what? I finished Grand Day. Oh my God, that film I recorded 7 years ago. And, you know, that's how long it took from when he did recording to get the film finished.
You think? Wensleydale. Stilton. I don't know, lad. It's like no cheese I've ever tasted. Try another spot.
There's a bit of opening when we're moving into our old building.
You're in Gasbury Road, right?
Just some silly video footage of us moving in to what is now our old building, but this is the first day about 1992. Uh-huh. Wobbly Cam by Dave Rodette, I think.
Yes.
There's a studio. We had this very The Bath Naturals do a kind of spoof thing with us. This was the creative space which became CGI, pretty well empty. And here's Nick. Working, I think, on the storyboard of Wrong Trousers, in fact. Yeah. It's quite an interesting story about how he wrote it. We had teamed him up with a writer called Bob Baker, who had done a lot of work on things like Doctor Who. He'd written Doctor Who's, he'd script edited Doctor Who's. And what Bob did was basically get Nick to A, open up his sketchbook, and B, so empty all his ideas out on the table. And they were random. They were discrete ideas which weren't really joined up. And Bob said, "Well, if you shuffle them in this order, you know, clearly there's a villain, there's a diamond, it's a heist movie. He's the villain. You've got this picture of this penguin with a rubber glove on his head. What's that about? Well, he must be disguising himself. So he's obviously trying to do something bad. Why is he hiding?" And very quickly they put the spine of this film together. All the images, all the key images in the film, are in Nick's sketchbook from two or three years before he started making the movie. And Bob just helped him kind of sew the plot together and then work on the gags and the rest of it.